So this is musicians having coffee and talking about stuff. Coffee is not mandatory, but talking about stuff is. And my guest today is the illustrious, the amazing Mr. Derek Shulman of all kinds of fame.
Hi, all.
Of Simon Dupree and the Big Sound.
Well, mostly... that's the most important.
Right.
That's what got me started.
And Gentle Giant, and that's where most of the prog people, most of you who are listening probably are going to know him from Gentle Giant, but also went on to have an amazing career as a record executive, and yeah, how's it going, man?
It's going okay. I mean, we're the good news about being around today rather than last year is that certainly in New York where I'm living, things are opening up. Well, they've opened up now considerably, which is excuse me, good news finally, because it's been a horrible year for everyone, not just me or you, or I mean the whole world has been turned upside down.
Yeah.
And finally,
you sounded so American there, by the way.
The summer's here and
Derek, you sounded so American. You said
I do.
Horrible. I love that. Horrible. have you become an American?
You know what?
God forbid.
Believe it or not, I did become an American about 5 or 6 years ago after about 36 years of having a green card. Excuse me. My throat is a little not laryngitis. But I was screaming so loudly when I went to the Nets versus the Bucks game 2 nights ago.
Oh, my goodness.
With the basketball, with my kids. You know, we got very, very expensive seats, and they lost. So my voice is a little shot. It's like after about 7 dates on the road, you know, you need a rest. But anyway.
Was it a good game, though? Was it a good game?
It was a great game, actually. I'm a fan of sports and basketball in particular. It was a great game, but unfortunately, the Nets got kicked out or knocked out of the semifinals. So anyway, here I am with a sore throat. Not after singing, but after shouting, which people said is the same thing for them occasionally.
Yeah. Right. I've been watching a lot of the playoffs in basketball as well. And the funny thing about me is, like, my son Will, he has to have a team that he's rooting for, or he doesn't even want to watch it. It's like watching great artists work. Those guys are so amazing. The stuff that they do, you know, so I'll be like, oh, amazing shot for, like, the other side. And my son will go, you can't say that. I'm like, well, I mean, it was an amazing shot. Those guys are crazy, aren't they?
Well, yeah. Oh, yeah. Listen, the athleticism of these guys is just unbelievable. They're such, you know, an amazing, all of them, every one of them are, you know, in such great shape and able to do things that, God, I wish I was even able to do when I was their age. I mean, not even close. It was fun. But unfortunately, the Brooklyn Nets were knocked out by the Milwaukee Bucks, and I hate them for it. But nevertheless, it was a great game.
Yeah, were you one of those guys? I love it when the camera cuts to the people, like, you know, when their team is losing at the last second, especially when they thought they were, like, if they were ahead and they thought they were going to win, and then they cut to these people that are just like looking so forlorn. They're looking so sad. The cameramen love that, right?
No, I enjoyed it. It was a great game because, anyway, it was fun to be there. It was also fun to be with my kids, my daughters-in-law, et cetera, you know, the whole family. And we spent a lot of money doing it. But anyway, it was fun. And
good.
Now we look forward to watching the games on TV now.
Yeah. No, but you know, you can't sing for us. I was going to ask you to sing On Reflection for us today, but I'm kidding.
Well, good. Okay, that's kind of why I kind of did the preface before this, just in case you said that. So anyway,
no, it's
I've only done that once recently, and that was for my son who put this video together. I don't know if you saw the proclamation video, the fan video.
Oh, yeah,
great. It was a lot of fun.
Yeah, yeah, really cool. Yeah, so, what a piece. Anyway. You know, it's great to pull that stuff out. So, and do you have the experience, like when I watched that, I haven't listened to Proclamation in some years, to be honest. And I was just like, wow, you know, the piece itself is so cool. Right?
Yeah. It is. Oh, listen, your band and your stuff is as cool as ours. So, it's good. The good thing about, what has happened, especially with Stephen, Stephen, I'm sure Stephen Wilson, is that, he's a fan and a friend, and he's made us the band, this is a band 40 plus years ago when we stopped, in fact, listen to the music we made back then and reflect on it in a different fashion, almost objectively rather than subjectively. It's good. It's damn good.
Yeah.
There's not too many artists out there that are doing things that I guess we did and your band did. I mean, many years ago.
Yeah.
It's still funny. Do, of course, you,
it can take years sometimes for me to be able to hear what we actually recorded, like to hear what's there and not what you wish that it was or how you, mm-hmm. What you wish your performance would have been. Or sometimes it can take me a long time, to really just listen to it like a listener, because you're so close to it,
right?
when you create it and then you work on it so intensely. And so it's great to get away and then listen again, isn't it?
Yeah, well, for many years, as you described in your monologue, actually, or your opening, my life was very different. I mean, we broke up the band in 1980, and from 82 to until now, I'm still doing things, but certainly the next 30 years were pretty much about being in charge of both executives and musicians, and trying to get my, give my experience as a musician, in the business world, if you like, as a head of a couple of record companies or two or three record companies, and understanding what it took, and learning to understand what it took before. This is, as the internet was taking over, as streaming was taking over, what it took for an artist to make it, if you like. And or not make it, and what it was, and how much there was behind the scenes, if you like, that unfortunately was nothing that I thought about when I was a musician full time.
Sure. Yeah, you're just doing your thing, and I was thinking about that. I was thinking about you guys. I listened to an interview that you did last, I don't know when you did it, but I listened last Friday, and you were talking about the early days in London. Some of you who don't know, because I didn't know, you and your brothers had this. It was your brothers, right, that you had the band Simon Dupree and the Big Sound with?
Yeah, that's correct.
And
yeah.
Were you like 16 or something?
Yeah, I was at grammar school. My brother was, we were both at school. My elder brother was, had left school. He was a teacher, Phil. And we were on the road literally 8 or 9 days a week, being at school as well, and literally not getting any sleep when I was about 16, 17. And, we had a couple of very, very big hits.
I listened to Kites.
A very popular song.
Yeah.
It still is, actually, on BBC. So
I love the gong.
That was important. How you gonna put? You have to have a gong.
But you sound so mature.
Music, you have to have a gong,
right? Your voice is so mature on that record. I was like, he does. You don't sound 16. You sound like yourself. I was amazed.
Well, if you listen to Steve Winwood back in the day, he was 16 or 15 when he started, and his voice was like a a 37-year-old African American, you know, right. playing the blues down in Memphis.
Right.
I mean, it was the those were the days when, when musicians in England would listen to. Again, this is very interesting because a lot of American musicians and just generally a lot of people don't know that the biggest groups in the world, which including the Zeppelins and Beatles and et cetera, would listen to American music through American Forces Network based in Germany. And it was all Motown or even before the soul blues. And they were playing it for the troops based in Europe. And little kids in England, little white kids in England would listen to it and record it and say, man, that's great. And the American public at that time were still listening to Pat Boone or God knows what else we were listening to.
Right.
But that's what sparked the British invasion, if you like. American Forces Network and a pirate radio station called Radio Luxembourg, which is based in Luxembourg and played obscure American blues, R&B, and soul. You know, that was a start.
I didn't know that. I just assumed that everybody got import records of that stuff because that's the only way you could listen to it over and over. You know?
No, that was something that was rare. That was a Liverpool thing because there was a port, but certainly all of these bands that became became massive. We're talking about the Eric Claptons of the world. You know, they're
sure.
The biggest of the biggest, the Stones. We all listened to the radio, and the radio was playing American music to the American forces based in Europe.
Right.
So this is, whichever way that we developed, whether it was a rock band, a progressive band, you know, I would imagine, I would certainly say that Fripp and Peter Gabriel, and et cetera, all did the same thing. We all, turned in and tuned into to American music.
Yeah, to the soul music.
Soul music, and we gave it coming from, sort of a big, an island in the middle of the North Sea, if you like, we gave it the British spin, and it became British, the British invasion.
Right.
And then it developed as it did in a cocoon kind of thing.
Yeah. And you were, so there you are, 16, 17 years old, and you've got a couple top 10 hits. Right?
Yeah.
That's incredible.
Yeah.
What was that like?
Fantastic, actually, to tell you the truth. It was funny because I just remembered, and this is, I thought it was my imagination, but it isn't because it's logged into one of these, I went to grammar school, where you wear uniforms and the teachers wore mortarboards and cloaks, and I was lucky enough to get a scholarship, etc. And I remembered when I was 12 or 13, and they did a careers go around to the boys, it's a boy school, the kids in my class, 20, 30 of them, would answer what they were looking to do, and one would say, I want to be a chemist, I want to be a doctor, I want to be a surgeon. And this Mr. Rogers said, Shulman, what do you want to do? And I said, I want to be a rock star. And this is around, I was 13. And all the class laughed and turned around and yelled, yeah, boo, get out of here. And Mr. Rogers said, no, you shouldn't think of that because that's never going to happen. And 3 years later, or 3.5 years, maybe 3.5, 4 years later, I was on TV, on Top of the Pops. I was still at school. And I was signing autographs for the teacher. So
wow.
That's how it felt.
Well, how did that come about? Did you guys just find a studio and make some recordings? And then just, did you get a label behind you? Or did you go direct to radio? Or
yeah.
Direct to radio?
No. We were very lucky. My brothers and myself were very lucky in that my brother-in-law, my sister, had married a gentleman called John King, who became our manager, and he was a BBC television producer.
Oh,
so he was able to get to some people to at least get an audition at EMI Records. And let me tell you how back in the day, and again, you'd be probably interested because it wasn't just the Simon Dupree that did this. It was every band that was signed to Parlophone, including the Beatles, by the way. To get the record deal, and the record deal, by the way, was not an advance and you do X amount of albums, etc. The record deal was one single.
Really?
You'd go up to London, to Abbey Road. Yeah. Oh, yeah. It wasn't Abbey Road. It was Manchester Square. You'd go up to the Manchester Square. They had a soundstage there, and you'd play your full set in front of the staff producers and the engineers. They sit there like this, and you play your full set in front of them.
In suit, they're in suits.
And if they were impressed.
Right, white shirts.
Suits, yeah. Suits, and yeah, absolutely. Yeah. Right. Yeah, George Martin was there. You know, everyone was there. And if they thought it was worthy, they'd say, okay, we'll give you a deal. So we were lucky enough to get a deal. We were actually pretty good. We played live. You know, we played live a lot. And we were pretty good. So we got a record deal, which was one single. And by the way, the Beatles did the same thing. They didn't just, you know, Brian Epstein didn't say, come on, I want $1 million. They had to do the very same thing.
Yeah.
You know, you had to go and do your show in front of the producers. Anyway, so
that's
our
cool.
First single hit the top 40. It wasn't a big hit. It wasn't a big hit. Our second single was almost there. And then we had a couple of big top 10 singles, Kites included.
Amazing.
So that was a start. I left school and we were pro. We toured all over Europe. Ultimately, though, it was the millstone around our necks to have a pop hit, because you start to play in front of a crowd, which we call it in England the Scampionships crowd, which is basically they would sit there in their, I mean, you got good money for cabaret, if you like, almost cabaret performances,
right?
And up north, and they'd wait to hear your hit and not be concerned about the rest of the show. And it became very, very depressing,
right?
To the point of where we had decided to call it a day and change our styling completely, because first of all, that playing our hits, if you like, was only one part of what we wanted to do.
Right.
As you know, progressive means to progress, and we progressed, you know, both musically and ideas were floating around in the late 60s, early 70s that we wanted to explore, and
right.
To be stuck in that kind of void was horrible. So we broke up. And in fact, one of the, if you like, catalysts for our breaking up was our keyboard player at the time, Reg Dwight.
Oh, Elton John. Right?
Elton was our keyboard.
Oh, did I spoil the... I'm sorry. I'm like, oh, okay. Yeah, I'm sorry. Go ahead. Didn't mean to spoil it.
So Elton John, absolutely. Elton was our keyboard player. And we told him, and he said, that's a great idea. You know, I'd love to audition for you guys. And you know, we just met Bernie and we went to, you know, we became friends, and we continue to be friends now. And, you know, he said, I've got some great songs I just wrote with Bernie, and like Skyline Pigeon and myself and Ray became really friendly with him and them.
Yeah.
But unfortunately, you know, we said to Reg, you know, Reg, it's not kind of the style we want to do something a little more different.
I would say so, actually. Just a little more different. We should cut to a little bit of like our song and then play a little bit of Knots, right? Something just slightly different.
Exactly that. Yeah, but he was very supportive, and luckily for him, he didn't get the job, and he became like massive in the year, and we were still struggling to get gigs. So, that was the story of Reg and Elton John and Simon and Gentle Giant. But that was the start. So we broke up that band and started looking for players who could see the vision that myself and Ray and Phil at the time wanted to go in. And what we wanted to do is kind of the 180 from what we'd been doing.
Right.
So
and now for that, something that completely different.
Completely, Gentle exactly Giant. That.
Right.
yeah.
Well, that was right around the time that Monty Python's TV show was on TV, wasn't it? Wasn't it 70, 71?
Approximately. Yeah, yeah.
Yeah, yeah. And now for something completely different. Yeah. That's amazing.
Yep.
What a thing. So, but I was thinking I was thinking about this scene in London that you were part of, you know, like with Elton John's there, and you mentioned you'd stop at a restaurant in the night and The Who would be there, and, you know, it was like there was a whole thing going on. And sometimes we can be in the midst of something like that and not even really know that we are, you know, that there's something, that something's happening. I mean, that was a really amazing time. And, you know, I Thomas Vauber from Inside Out, right? You know Thomas?
Oh, yeah, of course.
Yeah, of course.
Yeah, very well. Yeah.
He said, yeah, you know, I've caught glimpses of these kind of seasons when a lot of amazing creativity is happening. And I just vowed to myself that if I ever had the chance, I wanted to be a part of it and I didn't want to miss it. And that was how he was talking about why he was so enthusiastic about getting involved with Spock's beard. Because he felt like it was like at the late 90s, there was this smaller, but there was a kind of a surge of creativity happening around that time.
Right.
Yeah, what a thing it must have been. Very exciting time for you all.
It was you can't describe. I mean, you had it with Spock's beard, and as you said, in the 90s, it's indescribable because in England in the late to mid to late 60s, early 70s, there was this you were probably referring to this cafe on the one motorway called the Blue Boar, and all the bands that had become and ultimately became the biggest bands in the world. We're talking about the Stones, Beatles, Zeppelin, Cream. They started in England. They do shows up and down the country before they even went to Europe. I mean, remember, England, the tunnel wasn't built then. You know, this is the UK, and you'd literally, and there'd be so many clubs to play. You could do literally three or four shows a day and night in England. And we've done it. I mean, the Simon Dupree, and still, you know, come back home and get a 2-hour rest. So they stop at this one cafe that was open all night. And this is on a freeway called the M1. And it was called the Blue Boar. And then you meet your friends there. You make a beeline for that cafe at 3 a.m. and have beans and chips, you know, horrible English food. But then you see Eric Clapton, you hang out, and the Zombies were hanging out one side, and Status Quo was there. And he's, how was your gig in Nottingham? Oh, it was shitty. How was your gig in Cambridge? It was better, but you know, and you got to know all your friends. And that's a lot of the bands actually got together from just hanging out in the Blue Boar. I mean, you know, Clapton and Jack Bruce confer in a corner, you know, when Jack was playing in the Graham Bond organization, you know, and Clapton was in the Yardbirds. You know, this is it was the birth of the birth of British music. Well, then it broke into America, and then it became massive. But it was such a creative time. It was just a time that I'm very lucky to have lived through.
Yeah.
Thank God I'm still living.
That's great. Yeah. Yeah. Not everybody made it through.
No, that's sad. That's the sad part of it, of course.
Yeah. So I first saw you guys. My first experience with Gentle Giant actually was not seeing you or hearing you. It was my brother, Alan. He went and saw you play at the Whiskey A Go Go. I think it might have been the In a Glass House tour or something like that. He came home, and I remember it very well. He came home just lit up. He's like, "Neal, you got to go see this band. They're doing things that I've never heard anybody do. They all play everything, and they all sing." You know, he just went on and on, and he gushed and gushed. So I went out and bought, I think, Octopus and Power and the Glory and In a Glass House. And, you know, obviously I've never been the same. It was such a tremendous influence because, like you, I was born into a musical family. You know, obviously you're
right. I know.
Your dad was a band leader, and there was all of that. And my father was a music teacher and a choir director. So I grew up like we were in my dad's boys choir for one of the things, and we would go to the Renaissance Fair and sing. Now is the month of May, when merry lads are playing. Fa la 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 la. Right. You know, so I grew up with a lot of this layered counterpointal vocal parts. And
Right.
And I'll never forget, I think it was the next year, I went and saw you guys at the Shrine Auditorium. You had graduated quite a bit. If you go from the Whiskey to the Shrine, that's a big capacity difference.
We did the Santa Monica Civic and then the Shrine, I think, then in LA. That was we step up from, you know, 3,000, 6,000, 7,000 seaters. And you were at the show at the Shrine?
I was, yes. And I'll never forget. I don't remember what the lighting guy did, but there was some special lighting thing that he did when you guys did, "You may know what I don't, but I don't know it, and I can tell you, so you will," right? And I was just like, "Wah!" When the audience cheered at the end of that part, it was I was cheering along. I just love that so much. And it was again a new possibility for me of bringing all these different things that I loved about music. You know, somehow we get into this idea that music's somehow limited, I think. And that's the great thing about bands and artists, is they'll open up vistas to, "Oh, I didn't know you could do that." You know, now thinking back, why couldn't you do that? Of course you can do that.
Well, you guys, you did and you do the same thing. I mean, you're not limited to one. You should not be limited to one particular thing. If you do, then you're a follower. You know, just be yourself and be unique, or not be authentic. And if you want to do that, do it. And if it works, even better. And if it works for yourself, even better. If it works for yourself and a fan, even better yet. You know, right. And if they enjoy it, and so you know, that's kind of what you did as well as a band, and what we did prior to your Spock's Beard, of course.
Well, I'm glad you're not upset with us, because the first piece that I ever wrote that was Gentle Giant-esque was a piece called Thoughts. And I remember sending the, because that was back, this would have been 96 maybe, or so we were sending cassettes back and forth in the mail back then. Mm-hmm. And I sent a cassette that had a bunch of my demos on it. One was Thoughts. And I kind of thought, I mean, I liked it, but I thought the band wouldn't want to do it because it was just so Gentle Giant, you know? And then it was my brother Al again that was like, "Well, actually, that was my favorite one." He said it's so subdued. You know, sometimes we just assume people don't like things. I don't know if you're like that, but I can be like, if nobody says anything, I assume they hate it. And so when my brother said, "Well, actually, that was my favorite one." Anyway, it was because Al loved it so much that we wound up doing it and putting it on the record. And then when we played it live, what a response it got. And so, you know, that became kind of a thing that we did. And then we did we do these layered vocal things. Of course, we had the instruments to do it. You know, we had Nick's voice was so wonderful on the he had such a high clean range, you know, and so we just had the right voices that we could actually do that stuff. But I always wondered if you guys would be upset thinking that, you know, because some of that stuff is very it's very Gentle Giant, some of that.
I'm aware of your music, of course, and I love it, actually, and I'm happy and I feel very proud that it was, we had some kind of influence on anyone. I mean, the fact that I'm still speaking about a band which I was in 40 years ago, which when we closed the door, speaks volumes about what, I guess, that has, it had a life that didn't just stay and die in 1980. It continued to flourish And apparently is even more popular now than it probably was back in the day, which is interesting because, you know, it was music, and I'm sure in your world too, that was, we were just doing what we did, and we weren't listening to other people. We weren't trying to be followers. We were cocooned in our little world.
Right.
And thankfully we had some, you know, the band had some fantastic musicians. So Carey having had a degree in composition, you know, made a huge amount of difference. I mean, he's just a brilliant musician. And Ray, of course, as well, was classically trained, and we all read, you know, we read music, but we're a rock band, but the truth is we weren't based in London. We were based in a town called Portsmouth on the south coast of England.
Okay.
So we were pretty much cocooned. It was near London, it was 60 miles from London, but we were cocooned there. And basically, when we recruited Gary and from London and Kerry from the West Country, et cetera, and John from Wales, they moved down to where we were. And effectively just brought our influences and our loves of what kind of music we enjoyed to whatever we were doing, which is Gentle Giant. And that pot was stirred, you know, and again, we weren't trying to be like anyone else. It was, those days were, thankfully, there were no sort of labels that you had to be a progressive, you had to be a hip hop, you had to do, you know, pop, you had to be a TikTok. This was those days when anything went.
Yeah. I think anything went. They were probably that way because at that time, the anything goes stuff was selling.
Yeah.
I mean, it was working. You know, so they would invest in bands like Gentle Giant, right? I mean, did you have decent budgets or what was it like?
Yeah, we did. I mean, yeah, we did. Well, we were lucky enough, actually. Then you talked about my first group. We were lucky in that we had a manager who, when we told him we were going to break up and start something new. We had a manager who believed in the brothers. And who basically continued to invest in the band to put the band together. So we were very lucky in that we were able to put bread on the table and find Kerry Bonnier, you know, who just graduated from the Royal Academy, and then Gary Green, you know, we auditioned about, God, 150 guitarists, and he was probably the only one who said, "Can I tune up?" You know, so we get.
That's why you got him.
So, you know,
we got to get this guy. He tunes up.
That's it. Yeah, he wants to tune up. Wow, this is cool.
He was more of a bluesy player, right? Wasn't he a little more of a blues guy?
Yeah. Oh yeah, he was very much a blues. He still is a great blues player. I mean, a fantastic player, but a real blueser. But a great player as well.
Yeah.
And, you know, ultimately John Weathers, we went through a couple of drummers. And we knew John from being in the Grease band and such a superb rock drummer, a real solid. I mean,
he was in the Grease band?
Also so solid and put the originally. Yeah.
Oh, I didn't realize that.
And then Eyes of Blue.
Okay.
Yeah.
With Joe Cocker, you mean the Joe Cocker? Joe Cocker in the Grease band, you mean?
Yeah.
Yeah. Oh, wow. I didn't know that.
Yeah.
Learning stuff all the time, Derek.
So well, me too, you know, and I'm old. So we put that band together, and you know, we were, again, fortunate that we had a manager, Jerry Braun, who's no longer with us, who believed in us as musicians. And we went into this and rehearsed this kind of different music that we'd working on, and went into the studio with Tony Visconti. And it was those days, again, in the early 1970, I think it was, we did one session, and Tony was working on three albums at the very same time. One was a T-Rex album. Can't remember which one it was. But then after our session was David Bowie and would come in, and that was Man Who Sold the World sessions. You know, so we all got to know each other really well. And in the other Trident studio, there was Queen. It was a great time. I mean,
yeah,
again,
that's amazing.
We're talking about you can't describe it. It's
So it's so cool that you guys that the label got somebody with a name like Tony Visconti to on your very first record to work with you guys on that.
Yeah. Wow. Yeah. Well, it was. Yeah. Yes, he did. That was. But Tony, you know, enjoyed what he heard and was very, very instrumental in a lot of things that we learned, actually. And also, Tony's such a great musician.
Right. Wow.
I mean, he was. He actually was, you know, full disclosure, the recorder quartet thing was his idea.
No kidding. You
know, so we took that on. yes, indeed it was.
Wow.
And in fact, so we stole it from him on stage, you know, and used it to our advantage.
That was one of the things my brother Al told me. It was like, then they all play the recorder.
Well, yeah, but it's not hard to learn, but I mean, certainly you had to know what the notes were and be able to breathe properly. But that was Tony's idea. So Tony was great. I mean, he was a fantastic mentor, and so we did the first album with him and the second album with him as well. So and we learned from him, and he was very hands off because Ray is certainly my brother Ray and even myself wanted to know a little bit more about. What does this button do? How does this work? You know, so ultimately, after the second album, we took over the production of the band.
Right, right. Well, great productions they are. I mean, they really changed my life. I mean, all those were the four records that I initially bought, and they were the ones that had the most impact with Octopus, Power and the Glory, In a Glass House, and Freehand. Freehand, wow. That was a big one for me. What's your recollection? Like any recollections of Freehand, making Freehand, or the tour, or anything you'd like to share?
Yeah, Freehand was actually it was a really good album to make because we were at our most mature best, if you like, having sort of I'm talking about starting with Tony Visconti in Trident Studios and then AdVision Studios in London. And you know, as you know, you grow as a band. I mean, it's almost like a lifetime. You start as a child, you know, you're learning, and then you become a adolescent, and then a young adult, and then you become adult, and then you mature. And I think that the Freehand period, in the Power and the Glory Freehand period, we were mature as a band. We found our direction. We found our what we did best. And at that same time, we were also playing to some big audiences. I mean, we're playing to in Europe. I mean, you know, we were playing to, you know, in stadiums. A lot of people think we're undersung and, you know, not known. Well, we were playing to 20,000 seaters in Italy and Germany. And as you said, even the Shrine, we were selling out the Shrine and et cetera, et cetera. You know, we were on the radio, but certainly, so it was a very inspiring time to do that album. And in fact, the album was a very easy album to make and a fun album to make. And then I think we had found our footing during the Freehand period.
Yeah.
And I think that it shows in the music and in the direction that we were going in. And that's kind of a mature album. I really think that's probably one of our best.
I would agree. I just remembered, I had forgotten. You guys were so my band. In that season, you know, like when you're a teenager, you know, it's like me and my friends would get into this my band, you know, my favorite band can beat up your favorite band thing, you know, and for a couple of years there, I was carrying the banner of Gentle Giant so much. I bought a white doctor's jacket and I had the Gentle Giant like, I don't know, what did they call it? Yeah, when they iron it on there, what was that called?
I had
the Gentle Giant on the back of my white doctor's jacket, and that's what I wore to high school for at least a year. And
wow, do you still have it?
No.
Oh man, I was gonna say I'll buy it from you.
I'm sure it's all peeling out. If it exists anywhere, the Giant is long. Those they didn't make those things to last very well. But I had forgotten about that. Yeah. Oh. And I would go over to my friend Larry Marx's house, and we would listen to you guys and Crimson and all of that stuff. Little did I know. I mean, yeah, I think our parents, Larry, this friend of mine, was an extremely brilliant guy. a lot of these really smart guys that I was growing up with, they decided that all they wanted to do was smoke pot and listen to prog. You know, I don't know where it ever happened to Larry, but somehow, in God's great wisdom, he was able to use that time that I was spending. Because I, when I, as you know, as you're listening over and over, I was learning. You know, without knowing, right. I was learning. I was learning about how you guys layered the vocals, and oh, listen to that part moves. You know, you put the movement where the melody is pausing. Right. You know, I learned those things before. Later on, I went and took a music notation class, I think, at Santa Monica College, only because it was free. Really? Only because it was free.
Well, that is a good price.
Well, and it was the first time in my life. I've never really talked about this, but it was, I dropped out of high school because I knew I wanted to do music. And my father was a teacher and a music teacher, and he was very upset about it. But it was, you know, one of those very, you know, kind of dramatic, I don't want to fall back, you know. You need something to fall back on, son. I'm not going to fall back. You know, that I know what I want to do and I'm going to go do it. And Well, then some years later, I was like, you know, I think I would like to learn more. He was trying to encourage me to learn more about music notation and music in general. And, you know, at that time, I was like, well, you know, I think I know enough to do what I want to do. But I did go to this Santa Monica College notation class, and I learned even more about, you know, the kind of vocal arrangements that you guys were doing. You know, I learned more about, you know, they taught like, oh, if one part's going down, you want to have the other one going up. You don't want to have the two parts moving right. The same way. And all of these things, it's like all things somehow managed to work together to you know, make Spock's beard and other things possible. And I'm sure it was the same way with you guys, all these elements.
Carey's musical compositional skills were evident from the start. I mean, some, you mentioned Knots before. I mean, that was not a jam. Let me put it that
right.
way. that's right. You know, we didn't say just go in the studio and jam our vocals. You know, that was very, very scored and boy, you know, it was quite difficult to. Well, I mean, it wasn't ultimately when you learn the parts, it wasn't that difficult. Not difficult, but it wasn't outrageous. But certainly, every part was scored. And as you did in Spock's beard, in Gentle Giant, the pieces of music, I should say songs or pieces of music, there's always, I don't want to sound, you know, pretentious for the sake of it, because that's what something we never were, and we didn't take ourselves that seriously. But in the music itself, you'll hear themes, whether it's a bass part or the keyboard part, or even the vocal part. Vocal lines sometimes weren't the top line of a song or a chordal pattern. They were part of the arrangement, and it's quite orchestral.
Yeah.
I mean, that's the same. I know that Spock's Beard had the same kind of musical arrangements that Gentle Giant did sometimes. It was orchestral rather than,
We tried. We tried, but you have to have the mind that created some of those arrangement that you guys had was just, you know, really extraordinary. Even just Knots, that the ain't on it and do, you know, you're really creating this melody and thing, but you're playing it on different instruments, you know, so. It's just incredible, some of the arrangements. And what was the first song on the second side of Octopus? Did that just come in? Was that the one?
No, that was In a Glass House. That was
In a Glass House. Yeah.
I've got Octopus over there somewhere, but I would deign to look. But
I just remember it just comes in with this incredible, like the bass is, do, you know,
give me a second.
Okay.
I'll take a look. Hold on. Where is Optimus? I've got it here somewhere. Yes, I do. And it's going to be opened.
I'm enjoying this piece of artwork you have, by the way, Derek.
Oh, yeah. It's some done by a quite a famous artist called Amos Rubin.
Oh.
Rubin. And we've got a couple of his pieces. It's a orange juice, a juicer from Jerusalem.
Oh, wow.
But he's... Yeah. So, let me see what... I'm actually physically opening...
I see that.
Here just to see what it is, because it's hold on. Oh, damn it.
It's funny. We don't okay. I was speaking with John Anderson, I think, and he was like, so what was on the Yes album? I think it was one of the albums, you know, one of their bigger albums, and he couldn't, is that song on that? Or, you know, I mean, it's been some years. It's been some years, right?
So here's the Roger Dean cover.
Yeah.
And it's not started the second side.
Oh, not on the American version. By the way, why did the American label not use the Roger Dean cover?
I think they just wanted to, it wasn't a negative thing on the Roger Dean cover. It was just they wanted to establish branding, if you like. You know, there were the Columbia Records, you know, the face was, you know, was recognizable and you know, it was, you know, I think it was certainly, it still is, I think, the branding of the face of Gentle Giant. And I think it was very clever. It was no negative connotations on Roger Dean, certainly.
Right.
I like the Roger Dean.
Yeah.
But, and in fact, that's an interesting story too, because I'll harken back again to the very first sessions. And that Giant, I don't know if anyone knows this, was done by the best friend of David Bowie, a guy called George Underwood.
Really?
George was Bowie's best friend from school. And he was hanging out in the studio with Bowie, and Tony Visconti at that time said, you might want to meet George because he's a great artist, and maybe he can come up with something. And he came up with the Gentle Giant one, the first album with him, the Giant, holding us in his hands. And that was George, because Bowie was there with George. That's what I said. It was a mix and match of all these other artists doing the same thing. And meanwhile, Mark Bolan was writhing in the studio doing, you know, Bang a Gong or something. We were laughing at him because he looked ridiculous, you know.
So you're having a bit of a chuckle about him, like, oh, look at this guy, right?
Oh, yeah. Yeah. Oh, God. Look at that guy. He's actually literally riding in the studio on his back, you know. But we were cynical, to say the least. But that's
right.
Okay.
Yeah. You always got to make fun of everybody else because your band's so much better.
No, it wasn't. Not that at all. I mean, we're just laughing because he took his stardom a little more seriously than we did.
Right.
You know, we took our music seriously. But we never took ourselves seriously. And that's something that, you know, even on stage, and we would like to laugh. We like to enjoy. We love to, you know, we love to enjoy what we did musically.
Yeah.
Personally, for ourselves. And I hoped that it came over on stage because.
Yeah, I think
it
did.
Smiling on stage. Yeah, because that's important. You know,
yeah.
a lot of our contemporaries, as you know, will play their music, you know, and say, bad, you know, and not look up to see what the audience looks like. And, you know, think that the music itself will wow you, the crowd, to the point of like them being, you know, in awe. Well, we were never like that. We just wanted to have fun playing what we did and having smiles on people's faces. So we had fun together.
Yeah.
You know, that's we took our music seriously, but we took our entertainment, if you like, playing the music with a pinch of salt and enjoyed what we did. And hopefully that enjoyment came through to the stage.
Yeah, Spock's was like that too.
Anyway.
We were pretty crazy back in the day. We were, Pete Travis describes us as like a bunch of completely mad people playing some completely mad music. We didn't take ourselves very seriously.
That's probably,
yeah.
Well, that's probably the best quotation you probably have.
So, you know, we've got to touch on the later part of your life. Obviously, it's pretty well known that you got Bon Jovi signed and other people like Slipknot and different groups. And,
yeah.
So you kind of came to the end of this thing. It's like, well, what am I going to do now, right?
Well, effectively, yes. I mean, the 1980 tour. I mean, you've been in the band. You know when, you know. I don't know. In your case, when Spockspear you decided when Spockspear was. I haven't spoken to anyone about when you say it's time to call it a day and when you reform or what. You know, I don't know. But I knew in 1980. That we've done relatively well, but the bands of our ilk, you know, the you mentioned Crimson but certainly Genesis, yes, they were able to pull out a commercial hit. Gentle Giant never were. I mean, I think we tried our best, but I think in certain respects we almost like self-destructed deliberately because we couldn't do it. So ultimately the last tour. In 1980, it felt like touring just because we needed to make the money to put bread on the table. And when you're a creative artist, and when you go on the road and think, oh God, I've got to go on the road again after. When you start feeling like that as a creative person, when you feel like you're clocking in, it's time to stop. Yeah. As far as I'm concerned, I think it's time to. So we did the tour. It was a great tour, but when it feels like a job,
mm-hmm.
I'm very lucky in the fact that I can say that because most people who have to clock in have to clock in, and that's what they do. But it felt like a job to go on that tour, and therefore it was time to say. Not anymore. We did the tour, the last tour. It was a successful tour. And then we stopped. There was no plan. I mean, I had no real plan afoot to do anything. I was in California at the time myself. I got a couple of calls saying, you want to produce? You want to do this? You know, and I kind of didn't know. I was kind of at odds, actually, in a kind of wilderness. But I knew I didn't want to continue. I didn't want to continue and become, forgive me for other, if this reflects on other bands, a parody of myself, playing the same things to the same audience and kind of whittling it down to clubs. That was not what we wanted to do. And I got a call from a friend from London who now is working in New York saying, have you ever thought about, joining the enemy? The direct company.
Right.
And I said, no. He said, well, anyway. I got a call and I spoke to a guy in charge of a department of Polygram Records. And he said, we'd love to speak to you because, there's a couple of well-known consultants, radio consultants. And radio was very important back in those days.
Yes.
Jeff Pollock and Lee Abrams, who were big fans of ours. And you can perhaps get to them quicker than I can. Anyway, I went to New York and I got this job, to work at a record company. And that was 1982. And my first job, in fact, was promotion. And that was hilarious. I mean, having to promote, bands that I was not sure about, like The Jam, which is, they were, I got on with the musicians. Thankfully, that's one thing that I always brought to the table as an executive, if you like, in quotes. I mean, I hate that stupid word. Having to work with some artists that, were hard to deal with. But anyway, the bottom line is I moved into A&R at Polygram, and my first signing was indeed Bon Jovi. I saw something in him that... it's funny. I saw something in him that Gentle Giant never had. It was a drive, an uninhibited drive to make it to be the biggest artist in the world. He wasn't that great at that time, honestly, but he had this amazing, he wanted to be the next Elvis. And when you see that something in someone's eyes that is that driven, you think I have to sort of nurture that. Anyway, bottom line is that was the first signing, and then I went on to sign other bands in Polygram, whether it's Cinderella, Kingdom Come, Man Without Hats, Tears for Fears, and then I got an offer to run Atco Records. That was the end of the 80s, and revitalized that label. And signed Pantera and Dreams. Our buddy, Mike Portnoy's Dream Theater,
right?
Who would put this? That's who introduced me to you, of course.
Yeah.
And other big bands in Atco, AC/DC. I worked with to revitalize their career with Razor's Edge. A lot of big bands in Atco, and then I went on to run Roadrunner with signed artists like Slipknot, as you said, and was lucky enough to do that.
I didn't know that. I knew about Atco. I did not know about Roadrunner. Oh yeah. Okay. So that's in the end of the 2000s, Roadrunner now, right?
So I ran that, and I brought that from a kind of a little death metal label to a pretty damn big label. Nickelback was the biggest back artist that they had, and still do. And I was party to signing Nickelback as well as Slipknot, et cetera, et cetera.
Yeah.
So it's all part of my history, if you like. But the interesting thing, excuse me. I'm sorry if I'm doing a monologue on you here, man.
No, but, go.
It's just interesting having had the decades, if you like, behind me of, and hopefully in front of me, a few more, or a couple more anyway, at least, of being in the music business and having music around. What people want to know more about anything and anyone is about me as a musician, music. Not the business, not the who you knew, what bands you signed, who you hung out with, you as a musician. And that's the thing that is interesting to me personally. And I would think the same would go for you as well. Whatever you've done all over the other place, whether you became the most famous podcaster in the world or whatever, I'm serious. What's fascinating to me is that all the other things that you're associated with are secondary to what the music you made personally.
Right.
And that's you.
Yeah.
And that's something that's come back to me, understanding what's the most important thing about what you've done in your life.
Yeah. Yeah.
So, being part of a pretty damn good group. And I was lucky enough to be surrounded by some great musicians and really good people, and had a fantastic time doing it. So whether the following 30, 40 plus years of being running labels and having big artists and big gold records on the wall, et cetera, that was fun. I can't deny it. However, coming back to where I started as being a musician is the most important.
Yeah. Yeah. Well, definitely. So it's been the centerpiece of my life. That's for sure. Yeah.
Well, you're still doing it, of course.
And yeah. Still doing it. Still
loving it. I envy you there, but in some respect.
Yeah. Writing.
In fact, I think are you going on the road again?
Yeah. There's some, NMB dates. Yeah. We got some, dates. There's Morse Fest, of course, October, 9th and 10th or something like that. And then we're doing some American shows. Great. Not very many, like 9 American shows, I think. And then Europe all the way in June. Just, I'm not sure how that all happened, but I'm happy to get out and play still. I still love to play. I really love to write. That's just my favorite thing. And so I'm just always, I'm so thankful to, still be inspired, really, is the main thing. Just to wake up in the morning and feel that inspiration of like, I feel like I should write something, and then you start to do it and it starts to come to fruition, and it's just yeah, wow. What an amazing thing that music is, you know, and I'm so glad to have been able to be a part of it. And in this time in human history, you know, when, cause there were a lot of moments and seasons in human history when you wouldn't have been able to actually make a living from just writing whatever music or play, you know, like you guys did, just playing whatever you wanted to play. I mean, that's an amazing gift. You know, I mean, in decades and seasons and, you know, centuries past, you would have to get a contract from a benefactor or something to pay you to write.
Yeah.
You know, it's
like, of course, you had patronizing a patron.
Yeah,
I mean,
get a gig with the church or something. Movie. Yeah. Yeah,
exactly. The church or your patronage or whatever. Yeah, we were lucky in that respect. Absolutely. Did you write during the pandemic? Did you?
Yes, I did. I wrote a whole concept album called Sola Gratia, based on the Apostle Paul, and you know, that whole thing. Oh, that old thing. Yeah. it went down very well. It was a wonderful, wonderful thing to be able to do that and have a home studio where you could actually do something very viable. What about you? How was it for you?
It was horrible, actually, but nevertheless, what I did was, you know, I took out my alto.
That's where we started.
I took up my alto sax and I got guitars by the ton here, you know, but, you know, thankfully I have a study, which I'm talking from, which is away from anyone else in the apartment here and started, you know, getting pretty good at my alto and baritone. So, yeah, I got my sax out and made a lot of noise. I have my little, my Logic set up and, you know, did some music myself, but,
great.
You know, only for me, not anyone else. I mean, it was but it really is. It's something that, again, it's in your blood. I mean, if you have to, you know, be part of it's part of who you are. But I'm happy that the bands are getting out again and the shows are going to be back on track again, because it's horrible that a lot of people were not able to make a living and live their lives properly. Not just musicians. I mean, we're talking about everyone.
Yeah.
But you know, I'm happy to see that shows are going to happen again and music could be heard again live. Cause there's nothing like live music. I mean, whatever the streaming services are, whatever, you know, this, that, and the other. I'll tell you one interesting thing that happened over the last few years. And I'll just, you know, somebody asked me a question about progressive music. Well, let me ask you a question. I mean, your influences and what do you listen to now, and what don't you listen to, and what don't you like? I'm going to turn the table here and be the interviewer. What are your influences?
Oh, well, my influences they're pretty vast. But I mean, I would just stick with the progressive ones. It would be, you know, you guys, Gentle Giant, and you know, Yes, and Genesis, and ELP, and Jethro Tull, and The Who, also, and then singer songwriter guys like Simon and Garfunkel, and I don't know. I mean, I listen to a lot of jazz and classical music still. So I'll put on Miles Davis radio and on Pandora or Mozart or Rachmaninoff or, you know, things like that. Yeah.
You know, we're in the same school there, but what don't you like? Is there any kind of style of music that is an anathema to you?
Well, you know, I'm not exposed to it very much, but, you know, I don't listen to very much like, you know, hip hop or rap or anything like that. I get tired of things. Like if my wife likes to listen to popular music, and a lot of times it's just kind of, you know, she likes Maroon 5 a lot. And so, you know, I like Maroon 5. I just sort of get tired of it. You know, it's like, whereas somehow, with the jazz and stuff, I don't find myself getting as tired of it. But
yeah, no. The reason why I'm asking, part of the reason why I'm asking is you know, I didn't quite, you know, for years I was not sure about what hip hop in that world was and is. But what I realized more and more in recent times is they're probably the most progressive musical artists out there. Actually, they're progressive. I mean, if you listen to some of the stuff that's really clever, I mean, okay, they don't exactly make, you know, write the riffs themselves, but they put together these different styles of music and make it something which is different, completely different to what you would expect. I mean, some of the mixing and matching is damn interesting. And part of the reason I'm saying this is because a lot of these well-known hip-hop artists love the progressive bands. And in fact, Gentle Giant in the last year has had 3 number ones. I don't know if you know that.
No, I didn't know that.
In fact, you mentioned Knots. That was the that was sampled by a group called Run the Jewels, and it was the lead track on the Black Panther movie.
Really?
So what? if you
yeah. I got to go check that out. Obviously they put some kind of a groove to it.
A groove, there's a groove to it, but the band themselves, I mean, it's two guys and a DJ. But I went to see them in before the pandemic. And they're huge. I mean, these artists are huge fans of probably Spock Spirit as well, you know, but big fans of progressive music.
Wow.
And they have more musical, latitude and love of whatever is out there than, you know, the TikTok world, if you like, or the sort of the pop world, which is, as you know, is pretty much machine driven these days and mechanical. Mm-hmm. And it seems interesting that I'm seeing that a lot more. It's just you know, even I'll tell you a little sidebar story, which is kind of party to it. I was, as you know, I'm working in the business part of the world, and I had to take Ann Wilson of Heart over to the Tonight Show for Jimmy Fallon. You know, about 3 or 4 years ago it was. And I was backstage with Ann and you know, hanging out, and the musical director, I forgot his name, said, "Are you the Derek Shawn of Gentle Giant?" And I said, "Yeah." I mean, it was a surprise that he even, you know, knew the band, forget my name.
Right.
And he said, wait a minute. And then out comes Questlove and the band, The Roots. And poor Ann Wilson was in the corner, and they were asking for my autograph. So it's really bizarre, because, you know, and there's this fantastic, they're really intrigued and love music, which is different and something that gets their juices flowing. So it's interesting that the hip hop world is probably the most progressive world out there.
Wow.
You know, and I didn't realize it myself.
Yeah.
Until I just saw what was, you know, they listen to interesting, quirky things. So, yeah. You know, don't dismiss it. I did for a while, you know, but it's something to be listened to.
I'll check that out. I really want to hear this. But this treatment, yeah, of Knots.
Run the Jewels, but that was a big, big hit. And in fact, I've got a gold record on the wall, you know, from Run the Jewels and those guys. You know, the guy, the lead guy's Killer Mike. He was Bernie Sanders' biggest advocate. He's very, very politically involved. Very smart guys.
Right.
Wow. Anyway, a bit of a sidebar story.
That's cool, man. Well, I'll check that out. Derek, it's been awesome talking to you. Thanks for being part
too,
of this, man.
Yeah, you too, man.
Yeah.
Me too. I'd love to see you guys and you yourself, you know, when we unlock ourselves and when you're playing out
there.
Yeah,
we do have a New York date in October, so I'll let you know. And if you can make it, we'd all love to see you.
Yeah, I'd love to see you, man.
Yeah. Yeah. Well, all the best to you and your family, and enjoy the rest of the basketball season. Clippers, man. Clippers.
Yeah, well, I'm rooting for the East Coast, but I want the Hawks.
Right. I said Clippers okay. because right, I think I'm probably, I must be the only Clippers fan. Whenever I say that, everybody's always like, oh, no, not the Clippers, you know. So I was expecting to get that reaction from you.
It's LA.
Right, it's LA, yeah.
Well, East Coast. Well, got to be East Coast.
Right.
All right.
All right, man. See you later.
You, man.
God bless you.
Yeah, bye-bye.
You take care.
Yeah, you too, man. Bye-bye.